receive that, I want you to receive that before leaving this morning. As we gather, I pray your mind will witness the opportunities that are before us. We have seen by way of the slideshow, the birthday bash, the annual church birthday bash will be 3 weeks today, on the 24th. I have been directed to work through the cup ministries tomorrow. I understand they are not happening. The youth and jams will be happening following worship this morning. So we are excited about these Bible ministries of the church taking place again as we move into the new year. Remember again, the ministry of the lunch function on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and the ministry of the food bank and the clothes closet on the third Saturday of each month. As we gather and worship this morning, you've seen by way of your bulletin, that we're remembering the visit of the wise men. They come and visit Jesus for a very particular reason, a reason that is very important to the writer of the Gospel of Matthew, the reason which we share as we gather for worship this morning. As we gather for worship, I invite us to stand with all the great music to us. Light, 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 and more light. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of God has risen upon you.
Nations are come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising.
When Jesus was born in Bethlehem, wise men came from the east to say, "Where is he who is born King of the Jews?"
We have seen the star in the east, and have come to worship him.
The wonderful light of the Lord Jesus Christ. Prepare for the word of God, the prophet Isaiah, the word we believe to be fulfilled as we share. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes round about and see. They all gather together, they come to you. Your son shall come from sent them to Bethlehem, saying, Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word, that I too may come and worship him. When they had heard the king, they went their way, and lo, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. This is the word of our Lord. Well, good morning, you radical, rebellious, revolutionary people, you. You didn't know you were this kind of people, did you? True, you don't look terribly radical, rebellious, or revolutionary. You do not speak in a manner that would be described as radical. You do not behave in a manner in which someone would point and say, you all are radical, rebellious, revolutionary people. Not at all. Still, the behavior in which you take part this morning, the song, prayers, the word, the giving, the setting itself with cross, and windows, table, cup, and loaf. It's all very radical and rebellious, revolutionary. Because what we do this morning is share in worship. This is behavior setting us apart from all other concerns. It is behavior setting us apart from lesser matters, that is, everything else. It is behavior most countercultural, radical, revolutionary, rebellious. So it is appropriate, very appropriate, that we share Matthew's account of the wise men's visit of Jesus this morning. Because across the years and across all the miles, there is strong, unbreakable connection between us and these wise men as they worship and we worship. Now, it may seem as if this is not such a big deal, hardly so disruptive as the manner in which I've spoken. Still, Matthew is very clear. Matthew is insistent in telling us the reason these wise men go to visit Jesus. We have come to worship him, they say. Well, in case you have forgotten that intent that is stated early in the story, Matthew reminds us as the story concludes. They saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Now, we're familiar, very familiar with the gifts the wise men give Jesus. Gold, frankincense, but what we tend to be less attentive to is Matthew's repeated announcement that the wise men have left their homeland, have traveled a great distance over a great amount of time to worship Jesus. Now, if that's the point we overlook here, take note. Matthew will not let us overlook his insistence on this, his insistence throughout his gospel, that the defining posture of the Christian to worship Jesus. Not only is this clear in this story about these outsiders, these non-Jews who travel great distance to worship the King of the Jews, it is also clear elsewhere in Matthew's Gospel that this act of worship is a signature concern for Matthew. You see, at least 13 times in Matthew's Gospel, he mentions worship. That's more than the other three Gospels combined. Worship is important, Matthew. Jesus calls the sea, the disciples respond now by worshiping Jesus. The women who meet the resurrected Christ take hold of his feet and worship him. The disciples who meet with Jesus before he ascends into heaven worship him. Others throughout Matthew's Gospel will approach Jesus and greet him in a posture of worship. You see, it appears for Matthew as he here in the midst of these outsiders. Worship is a signature concern for him. Okay, it may impress us not a whole lot. I say this knowing it appears that worship is a practice not important to everyone in our society. There are those voices we know who suggest that worship is a practice that is becoming less and less important. This appears to be the judgment of much of what we read and see in various media. In fact, you may have seen, as I did in last Sunday's local paper, the latest of what appears to be an unending series of articles speaking to how the faith practices of older generations are faith practices less appealing to following generations. The headline in the paper over this article, study. Most millennials are spiritual, not religious. Now, if you read this article, the result of a study undertaken by the University of Virginia, you read of how the millennial generation in particular wants personal experience, not the words of authority figures. In other words, as opposed to coming to a place where someone else does the bulk of the speaking, where an authority figure such as pastor provides guidance or instruction, an experience that is largely shaped by tradition. According to the article, what younger generations want is to do it themselves, to enjoy the experience, to engage in activity, to provide some kind of service or some kind of good. Now, whether or not we agree with these findings cited by this research at UVA, we do know that conversation about worship can easily become a very sensitive conversation. We may get stuck on talking about the styles of music appropriate for worship or the selection of the hymns. In conversation about worship, we may get stuck on the manner in which the Lord's Supper is served, attention versus kneeling at the rail, receiving the individual cups. Again, worship conversation can be very sensitive conversation. That is, if it's even conversation we want to share. We may wonder, is it really that important? I mean, we know that thoughts here in worship can easily drift elsewhere. We should start thinking of more practical matters. Worship can be pushed aside for other matters. Miss certain other activities that take place at this time, we may face some terrible consequences. But if we miss worship, what are the consequences? So just how important can a conversation about worship be? Ask Matthew. For Matthew, it appears this is the most important conversation. Now, I don't know what concerns, if any, Matthew had about styles of worship. I don't know if he had any preference regarding the administration of the Lord's Supper. But it's apparent from the witness of his gospel, from the accounts of so many in his gospel who respond to Jesus by worshiping him, that Matthew sees worship as central to the lives of those who follow Jesus. Notice again, the first persons to visit Jesus in Matthew's gospel worship. Now, we may be familiar with the fact that not only do the wise men present gifts in worship, they come from a distant land. In other words, these visitors who first worship Jesus are foreigners, strangers. They're not from Bethlehem, Jerusalem, the Holy Land. These kings may know nothing of the commandments or covenant. They never heard of Abraham or Moses or King David. But they know who to worship, these outsiders. And we notice again this pattern that is so prevalent in the witness of Scripture, the pattern being that those on the outside so often discern and are obedient to the purposes of God more than those of us who may be on the inside. So notice how it is that with this offering of worship, these outsiders, they anticipate the fulfillment. The words of the Apostle Paul. bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that in the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And with this offering of worship to this newborn king, these visitors claim the vision of John the Revelator. Then I looked and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads and myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power, wealth, wisdom, might, and honor, and glory, and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all therein saying, "To him who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb be blessing, honor, glory, and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. These outsiders get it, don't they? And they show all of us that as we worship, we are answering this question: what is most important in your life? These outsiders get it. For as they worship, they witness to the one who orients our lives. These outsiders get it. In their worship of Christ, they witness to that which now directs our lives. As they worship, these outsiders answer questions as to whom they belong. As they worship, these visitors from a distant land witness to what will last, to that which is eternal. As they worship, those who have traveled a great distance with gifts so as to worship this newborn king, at the same time show us that worship is life-saving, worship is life-giving. As they worship, they witness to us of where life is to be grounded when all else is chaotic. As they worship, these strangers give a glimpse of God's future for us all. It's that future into which we live now as we proclaim the Lord's word and as we gather at the Lord's table. As they worship, these visitors who have traveled a great distance show us this: worship truly is sanctified. We may understand now how it is that King Herod and all of Jerusalem with him are upset with these foreigners who have traveled a great distance, not to honor him, but to worship this child born king. How upsetting worship is to the principalities and powers. See again how this worship shows us to be radicals, revolutionaries, those who say no to the powers and principalities, those who say no to temporal and transient ways of the world, those who come to worship the one alone who is worthy of worship. So could there be a better text than this with which to begin a new year? O taste and see, the Lord is good. And O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. With this new year before us, I wish to invite us to share in a covenant prayer in the Wesleyan tradition. Prayer proposed by John Wesley, founder of this Methodist movement. It is a prayer that is drawn from a much larger service of worship, a service of covenant renewal. But I invite us, as we look into this new year, look at committing ourselves again to the service of God, I invite us to call together these words of prayer. They are, of course, also number 607.
what thou wilt, grant me to whom thou wilt, put me to doing, put me to suffering, let me be employed by thee, or laid aside for thee, exalted for thee, or brought low for thee. Let me be full, let me be empty, let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and bestowal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine, so be it. In the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen.
We share now a time of prayer, a responsive time of prayer that we know as prayers people. I will offer various petitions, including each of these petitions, with the words, Lord, in your mercy, and invite you to respond to hear our prayer. I invite you as well to name those concerns that you may like to speak as we share in this time of worship. Together with us. Lord, in powerful and gracious ways, you remind us again how you have set a place for each of us at your table. You call us from near and far. You call us from every background and every history. You call us from every name, every tribe, every place upon your earth. For it is your desire to feed us, to welcome us, your desire to be hospitable and gracious. So much so that you give yourself, your body, your blood, so as to be with us, so as to forgive us, so as to enter into covenant with us. Lord, we give you thanks.
stopped all they were doing and traveled to worship the coming of God's love into this world. We would like to be those who care for God in all vulnerability, who cuddle and comfort the growing child, that he might know love and safety. And yet, merciful God, we recognize all times we are more like Herod. Whenever we, in our actions or in our inactions, find our own need for control, more compelling than the needs of others, our health and safety. Whenever we cling to the security of our privilege, rather than standing up for the rights of the oppressed. Loving God, we confess our sins against you and one another, and pray that you will fill us with your light, that we may live our lives as true disciples in your name, without coming to cost. In the name of Christ, the one who showed us the way, we pray.
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land that was our gift from you. You raised us up, making us a light to the nations, they might behold your glory. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Now, with the confidence of the children of God, we there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. This is the table of our Lord, which he invites each of you. It is his table. Each of us is his guest, and we are invited to his table. As you come forward, there will be two stations here. You will receive a portion of the bread as it is offered to you. Having received that, you will be invited to dip that into the cup that will be held for you as well. Having received the body and blood of Christ, feel free, as you make your left, to kneel here at our communion rail for a time of prayer. Come to the table of our choir. Thank you. light before us, that all may be illuminated, and that the light may shine on all. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.